Can I quickly just tell just a quick story about Steve, and that is that I was a really big fan, and I was about to make our first record with Not a Surf, and I went to see Guided by Voices open for Urge Overkill at the Beacon Theater, and the top balcony was pretty empty, and I was just sitting up there with a friend, and I saw this guy sitting there. I was like, oh my God, that's Steve Wynn. And I'm not good at going up to people. I sat next to Mitch Easter in a subway with a demo in my pocket, and he was reading the paper, and I just didn't want to bug him, you know? But I went up to Steve and introduced myself, and he was so gracious, and I said what I was doing, and you asked me for my address, and I sent you this tape that was going to turn into a record, and you wrote me a letter, and it was so moving. First of all, you liked it, which is incredibly validating for somebody who, you know, like a lot of people, I grew up like a floater, but also kind of an outsider, you know? And that meant a lot to me. And you also said, this is your record, and make sure to make it the way you want to, because you're the one who's going to care 20 years from now what it was like. And anyway, I thank you for that. I really treasured it. And what's really strange is I'm not sure where it is, and that's because for a while, it made me feel so cool to have gotten it, that my relationship with it was weird, because it reminded me that I cared about that, and on another level I didn't want to care that I was cool, you know, but this letter felt so cool, so I would be very upset. It's in a box somewhere, but thank you so much for that. Yeah.
Jeremy, I mean, you're sitting among, I mean, you're new to this group, and welcome, and hope you'll remain a part of it. But do you have any questions or any observations about what we're discussing? Or
yeah, well, I'm very much enjoying just kind of soaking it all in. But I'm actually wondering about. I heard some snippets earlier, Bob. I think you were talking about. I heard a little thing about songwriting process, and I'm wondering how much of an everyday thing it is for everyone here. Like, are you very disciplined about it? Do you write every day? Is it kind of whenever you compile things and then it ends up coming out when it's time to write a record?
Do you write every day, Bob?
Do I write every day? Yeah. Some days I wake up very driven to write. You know, it's pretty much get up, make oatmeal, make coffee, make more coffee, make more coffee. Get right into the room and just sit and start playing and see what happens. Stacks of words, you know, I can always just pull up some words from 3 weeks before or a week before and look at them, and melody meets words and you do these things. I try to do it every day. I mean, it's, you know, there's so many adages about, you know, it's not work if you love doing it. I think it's what all of us do day in and day out with our lives. You know, we talk about our work and we play our work for people and stuff, but ultimately it's that getting up in the morning and just really applying yourself and being very grateful that you get to do this with your life, and you don't let it rust. You know, you have to shake it off every day, and you know, some days it's like, you know, 16 bars of nothing. You know, other days it's like the songs that you'll play till they put you in the ground. It's, you have no idea what's going to happen, and if you don't know if you don't do it. So I think it's all about constant attention to the craft.
So you have a new record coming out, right?
Yep.
Would you maybe do a new song?
Yeah, sure. I played that song Hardly Getting Over It earlier and talked a little bit. You know, it's that sort of first touch on you know, mortality, which, you know, at 25 nobody wants to talk about. And then, you know, fast forward, and you know, when you start to lose people in your life, you know, you lose close friends, you lose a parent, you lose the people that, you know, brought music to you, and you have to, you know, for me, I had to stop and think about, well, I delayed the thinking about it, but when I finally started thinking about it and what it all meant, again, it was trying to put that glove on as gracefully as possible, and I'm not sure I did it, but I think I got a really good song out of it, so... Let me try to play it without pulling my head off.
Okay. I may cry. Matthew, will you cry if I cry?
I'll join you. I'm here for you.
What's it called, Bob?
It's called The War. The War. If I hit this hard, it'll be okay?
Oh, yeah, go for it. Absolutely.
And all these songs I write for you tear me up, it's not hard to do. Listen to my voice, it's the only weapon I kept from the war. From the war, from the war, from the war. And I can soothe every ailment you endure. And I can see into the future most assured. I don't have a choice, it's the only life I know after the war. After the war, out from the war, from the war. And everything we made reduced to dust. You were the one who taught me most. Carry your remains, your emblem and your name. Nothing left will ever be the same. This war we fought was violent and long. The weeks turned into years, but we kept on keeping on. The ringing in my brain is what remains, is what remains, is what remains. This war has worn me down. Broken dreams and a hole in the ground. Don't give up and don't give in.
Holy shit. I feel like we should
see,
be doing...
See how I did that with the answer?
Yeah, and it was good. And then the pause, which is always effective in songs. So we have 2 minutes left. Should we write a rock opera?